Hey guys, today we're going to do a video to show you guys how to clamp the wiring on the front of a VQ. And I'm going to show you two different ways of doing it. So first I'm going to show you how we have it set up right now, because I think this is the most durable way having the wire out like this. And then we're going to show a different way putting the wires underneath, which would be more for looks. This video is to help people clean up the wiring on their engines, but not do a full wire tuck. There's nothing wrong with doing a full wire tuck, but there is more work involved. So when dealing with a modern engine that has a lot of electronics, there is a lot more wiring compared to an engine like this. So this is a carbureted 350 cubic inch Chevy, and there's really no wiring. So we have the distributor, and we have electric choke, and then we have some stuff here for the charging system, and you have your ignition system over here. There's nothing else going on. However, on this car, on our 350, we have wiring harnesses all over the place. So we're going to go over some tips to help you move wiring around and just get out of the way so it's a little bit more aesthetically pleasing. Because most times, there's an engine cover on here. I'm not a big fan of engine covers. I think they retain a lot of heat, and it's also a place for rodents to nest. So we take the engine covers off, but then you expose all that wiring, and it doesn't look that good. Most of these tips today are going to be most beneficial for the rev-up engine. So you can see here, we have these plugs over here for our exhaust timing. I at first thought these were for our cam position sensors, because I'm like, oh, here's the cams, and this is, must be a sensor. No, the cam position sensors are on the back of these engines. So those of you with regular DEs, you only have one of these on the cover. So the rev-up engines have a secondary one over here. That's for the exhaust timing. So we have more wiring that we have to deal with, because most of you with regular DE motors can just move the wiring back, and we're going to show you how to do that. When you have a rev up engine, you have these plugs over here. You can route them up front, but there's actually an opening through here. You can route them back underneath and through. Now, the only concern about that is you are going to put in an area that is significantly more hot. So we have to deal with heat. And I'm going to show you some tips that you can do to help the wire withstand the heat, last a very long time, and get this look. Originally, Nissan has a big cover on top of here. Now, the main reason I'm not a big fan of covers is because I feel that they retain a lot of heat. It's also a place for rodents to nest. So the reason why they do is because they just kind of make it all work and make it reliable, then looks are the last thing. So in order to make an engine look good in a modern vehicle, they slap engine covers on. So we're going to try to relocate some of this wiring over here so I can put a new engine cover, one of the small ones, and we're also going to heat wrap these wires. That way, if there's any heat buildup, we don't wreck the loom or the wires themselves with heat over time. I am trying to save these clips. I don't want to just cut. You can just cut off if you want, but I'm just taking my pliers and prying this. That way, this slips off. That way, if I ever want to put this back, I don't have to go to the dealership and buy these specific zap straps. And you will have to cut this factory tape right here, and that will separate this harness. I'm a big fan of DI product, and I'm using their tape today to wrap all my wires. So what I'm doing is I'm putting it at a 45 degree angle and I'm wrapping it slow. This stuff does turn pretty well. Make every inch count. This stuff is not cheap at all, so try not to waste any of it, because you can use it on other items of the car. This is what the tape looks like if you don't cover it. So I'm deciding to cover it. I am probably reducing some of its reflective capabilities by covering it with this exterior tessa, but I do want it to look all the same. So basically, if there's any heat penetrating the exterior tessa, I'm hoping that this reflects it out and doesn't keep it all. And this is exterior tessa isn't exactly the best insulator. Like, you can't use it like an electrical tape. So I am picking a little bit looks over pure function on this one. This is what it looks like if you put exterior tessa on top of our heat tape. This is the heat tape by itself. I'll let you guys decide how you want to do it. Some of you might like this look. Like, it's all right. I'm going to tape over it black with black exterior tessa tape. I don't know. It looks too much like the space shuttle for me. Okay, we are done this part. This is the part that will be underneath the cover. So this is where I think heat's going to get really trapped. If you look at other parts in the engine, tape feels soft because the heat can just go around it. The tape's doing a good enough job insulating it away from the heat. Over here, I tried removing it. You could hear crackling, and then it would start to split. I think that's just mainly the tape, but the loom might have been starting to split as well. So by putting this on top, we're going to prolong the life of everything, especially for you guys that live in humid areas. Not only have to deal with the heat under here, humid areas, I found, like when I would visit Asia, things would just, rubber parts and plastic parts would just fall apart in the engine bays, or even just plastic things in general. So by reducing the heat here, you can get way more life out of the insulation to make sure that these are weatherproof seals. But if I ever unplug anything and I see that it's dry, I'll put a little bit of dielectric grease in there to help make sure I prevent any corrosion over time. So just a thin film. Go ahead and put that back in. I think I have it the way I want it. So you can see here, up to here has the heat tape, and then cover the exterior Tessa. So this has three reasons why I did this. One, my OCD's been kicking in harsh and I need to let it out, so I've just been doing stuff like this. Two, if that wire cover does retain some heat, this is going to help protect the wire. Three, I've been seeing, not really in cars this old, but I have been seeing lately in newer cars, rats nesting under the hood. Now this vehicle is parked in areas where I have a very low chance of that ever happening, but let's say I'm parked somewhere not at home and this vehicle is outside and this engine does get hot, they decide to come up here and they try to nest in here and they try to chew at the stuff, they have a lot of layers to go through to get at my wiring. So this is temporary. I don't know. I think I'm going to go with the Evo R wire cover. If anyone wants to comment, I don't know how tall it is. Basically, I've been seeing is people are moving the wires back, so I kept the factory one there for now. I clamped this one here just to keep it out of the way. I wanted to see how it laid out, if I was pulling on anything, how much slack I have. I'm actually pretty impressed with how good it looks by just moving it up here. I didn't do a full wire remanagement. Like, I don't know if people are extending the wires. I came down this way. So if you guys do it this way, you don't have to cut anything, because if you have to cut and solder, or if you have to use the butt connectors with the glue inside, that might be better for under the hood. But I'd rather not disconnect or cut any wires in an area like this. Like, there's lots of vibration going on here, lots of heat. I would rather just keep it all factory and make it more durable. So what you can see here, I have new bolts here. I made them match. And this is where the factory ground was. I relocated the factory ground up to here. It's all one piece aluminum. I see no reason why it can't go from here to here. And we have retwisted it so it's flowing nicely. Nothing really, no sharp bends, so this wire doesn't want to break off over time. So clamp, clamp, ran underneath. Use the factory bolts again to clamp it, create a drain. Try to create a drain loop here. So if water for some reason gets here, hopefully it just drains and drips off and doesn't keep going to the connector. So that's what we want to avoid. And up top we have like millimeters of clearance, but we're trying not to rest on any of the wiring. So I gotta relocate this guy over here. I don't think it's that big of a deal, but yeah, I have to like organize the wire in a way that's not touching anything, which is totally possible. So you see right there, so we're not touching anything. And I think this looks pretty good. It has like that factory look. I have seen people where they, like I said, they remove it. I think that looks the best, where they're running everything. This is more for if you're trying to go for that functional, cleaner look, because I want it up high. I don't want to go anywhere near the belts. I'm tucked back, so I had to make it serviceable in the sense that I had to be able to get at everything, and I had to basically shield it from all the heat because the wire was over here. Now I've moved it closer to the engine, and we're going to be putting a cover on here, so I had to account for all those things. But I can still take this off because I plan to change out this hose to a silicone hose, so I can just unbolt, move the wire forward, change the hose, put it all back, and it's not that big of a hassle. Okay, we got everything off again. Option two that I was talking about, you see there's this hole right here, and you can actually see the lower plenum. So there's a cavity, we can actually run the wires through down this way. The reason why I'm saying the first way is the most durable is because we're kind of basing on how factory set it up. So factory had all the wiring out here. Technically, it has more ventilation than opposed to being inside there where there's definitely more heat. But with the upgrades we've made, it shouldn't be an issue, and it's been proven by so many other VQ owners. So we're going to go ahead and run it through there. Option two is run through, so I have to finalize it now. So what I've done is taken all of that stuff off and run behind. So if you look here on the front timing cover, there is actually a big hole here. So it seems that the Nissan designers were kind of nice. This is the one time I really like engineers. They're like, well, you know, if you want to do something cool, we'll leave this here for you, but we can't actually do it for you. Because there's really no reason they had to. They could have made this solid if they really wanted to. So I think that's pretty cool that they did that. So we come up and over, and I ran it several times, and I was trying to find the best way to run it. So first I tried one this way, and then one on the other side, and I fell short here every time. You would have had to come into the harness, you would have to split it. And then I tried here, in between this vacuum hose, and I really didn't like it because this vacuum hose really pushes against the cover over here. So I thought, well, this gets hot, you're kind of asking for a chafing point, or it's too much pressure. It didn't make any sense. So the last way, I ran both of them behind the vacuum line down here and through, and there's more than enough slack. So that's my recommended way. You're not touching the metal, you are near the metal, but with all the upgrades you made, it doesn't make a difference. This ground wire that I added on has been here for 3 years. It's gotten quite hot over time. Now, it used to rest up right against the metal, and that's the worst that ever happened to it. That's direct touching it. So with direct contact to the metal, it can affect it, but it's not horrible. So this is a good test for it, that you can actually see what happens over time. So we're going to lay this out where it doesn't press up against any of the aluminum. All right, version two done. This is what you typically see people do. So you see, like I said, ran it down this way, came out here. I used smaller clamps because I had to have a clamp fit right in here, and I like to use these stainless ones that have the insulator on there, so it keeps it off of the engine. So it's not touching the aluminum, it's actually just floating in there. And then you see my ground wire. So what we can do is we can actually zip tie these three together, and they'll kind of hold each other in place. And here, I don't think it's that hot in here, but if I can manage them in a way that they don't touch anything, all the better. So I did have to readjust this twice because I had this one really tight. This one was okay. You want to be able to move it a bit. It's going to be hard to tell with that DI tape on there, but you don't want it to be tight pulling on the plug. Even though this whole assembly moves together, I never like having plugs that are having wires pull on the plugs. I don't think that's good for the wiring. So we had to make sure that we had a little bit of slack. Now, I wasn't able to create that drain drip loop over here because of how much length we needed. Like, I don't think we're gonna get any water on these. Like, drain drip loops are, you want it to come down low, so if it gets constantly wet, it'll drip at the lowest point as opposed to continuing into the plug. I don't think we're gonna have that problem here, but just things that you have to consider whenever you're running wiring. Let's go through this. So I have these spacers on here right now because these acorn nuts don't go all the way down. That will change over time, but I need those there temporarily. It's just there for looks, but this one is functional. If I were to keep this off, I probably would remove this bracket and run this same clamp just so it looks more symmetrical. But if I do run the cover, this is a better setup using how factory has mounted the wiring harness. And you can see that I've now, because of how I have everything positioned, I can have this ground fully straight. I think it's just a very clean look. It's amazing how making this one little tweak just cleans up the front of the engine quite considerably, and just it makes it look a lot more simple from what it was before, because with all the wiring harness in there, you're like, whoa, what's going on over here? Let's do some real world testing. So now that we have all our wiring laid out, let's actually see how hot it's getting. So let's look at the front cover. 71 degrees Celsius. Let's look at the upper plenum. Degrees Celsius. I found this interesting. So I'm using this throttle body as a heat sink, same temperature. Throttle body is a little bit colder, but over here where the intake is, see, it's cold, and then you get around here, it gets a little bit hotter over right there. That's where the heat from the exhaust manifold's coming off. So anyways, let's look at our rerouted wiring on top of here. Let's say 52 degrees Celsius, it's fluctuating. I found interesting over here, this one was cooler. Not by much, but if I hold it right there, right on the wire, I thought that was going to be way hotter. It's not. This one though, let's look at this down here. This is the one I'm actually most interested in. So that wire is 76 down here. And the cover is wait for it. Let's say 70. Fluctuating quite a bit here. 74. Sorry. So this general area is pretty hot. So right there, there's a hot spot right there. So this general area is roughly, let's say, 74, 77 degrees. Let's just check the hose. The hose isn't bad. So if our wire were to be out here, it'd probably be a lot cooler, because you have to think in here, like, it's kind of just trapped and there's just all this aluminum dissipating heat. So let's just get onto the sensor wire itself. So out here, it is cooler. So we're adding another, let's say 9 degrees Celsius. It's not the end of the world, but it is confirmed, it is hotter in there, like obviously it's going to be hotter in there. Out here it's not bad at all. So things you guys have to consider if you're going for like a track car, let's say, I would probably have your wiring out here if you're trying to get it as cool as possible, but like it's not the end of the world down here. I'll switch it to Fahrenheit for you guys. So this wire tape cover is rated at 400 degrees Fahrenheit of constant heat, like direct heat. So we're well under that. So technically, with that upgrade up here, we're well within our safe parameters. Like I said, I was concerned about here, so follow up with you guys. I'm taking this car for a long drive on Monday, so we'll see how it does. So to put that temperature into perspective for you guys, if you look at here, this wire over here, 51 degrees Celsius. This ground I found interesting. 70, pretty hot. So this area right here that's open because of the general area it's in is just as hot as down in there. And this has been on here for 2 years. That's the factory ground. Then I added that one on there. So it's been subjected to a good amount of heat, at least the same amount of heat as over there, and it's been fine. And if you guys are curious if it's colder in the back of the engine, should be. 52, 53, so up here, what are we running? 50 close. This one's a bit hotter up here. Up here, closer to the exhaust manifold, it's hot, but back here, down low, it's a little bit cooler. So if you did a wire tuck and you ran all the wiring back there, I wouldn't really worry about heat too much. What do you guys think? I always think less is more, and not having that jumble of mess out here is a world of difference. So I know a lot of people are, some people are doing wire tucks where they're putting the harnessing on the back of the engine. No issues with that. If you would have to extend some of the wire, or you'd have to rearrange a lot of it. There are pros to having the wiring up here. One, you can inspect it. I don't think there is, I think the heat would be the same front to back. I haven't measured it. I do have a thermometer. I should actually measure it to see if it's actually worth putting it in the back as far as heat goes. But if you leave the cover off, or if you have those small covers, it is a lot easier to do quick inspections on here. So for serviceability and durability, I'm going to vote keeping the wiring up here and then putting your cover over here. Nissan has put over here for a certain reason. It's been tested. These cars are getting older and I haven't seen any in the shop, and I haven't heard of anyone having any issues with it over here. Now, some people will do wire tucks under the fenders and everything, which is great for shows, but having the wiring in dry areas up top seems to be better in the long run. If these are street-driven vehicles, I would recommend that you keep it up here, because you're relying on the fender liner to keep all the debris and everything off of it, which it probably would do, but I just think having wiring in the engine bay, as long as you're far enough away from the engine, is more durable. If you like today's content, make sure to check out my channel and hit the subscribe button, and make sure to hit that bell notification. What that does is it makes sure that you're always kept up to date with all the content that we're providing with you guys on YouTube. So the way that we have the channel set up is I have the uploads up top. That way, at all times, you can always see, if you just hop by the channel, what our latest upload is. Plus, with the bell notification, you're going to get some sort of message from YouTube itself. We also have popular uploads, car videos, how-to videos, demonstration and informational videos, and a lot of cool other specific car videos like our builds playlist. I really like the builds playlist because it takes all the theories from our how-to section and it keeps applying it to different vehicles.